people, I don't know, it's like it's weird, like with people, like they might just be like, oh, I don't really give a shit, you know? Like, even
Well, I
people
don't
that are
give a
my
shit about what
friends.
you have to say. I have to start the show. That's the only transition that I can come up with, Matt. I'm sorry. So, hey, this
Oh,
is
are we on
great.
air now?
Yeah,
We are on
that
air
on
now,
sick. We
yes.
are on
Yeah.
air.
Cool.
I didn't we start my
Sounds
camera,
good.
so I didn't know to be like, oh, okay. But anyway, yes, this is Babetalk. Woo! Tonight we
Yeah.
have Matt from Finding Season.
How's it going?
We have Alex North of Alex Nordstrom.
I am from Alex Nordstrom.
And we have Dan. I never knew how to pronounce your last name, so I don't.
Cilitro.
Cilitro. So we have Dan Cilantro with us tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh no.
So before I start the show, I have to give an obligatory shout out to my two new friends that I made, Selena and Casey. Hey girls, going on? So, with that being said, I'm actually gonna start the real show. I started off every week by asking my guests how their day was. And today we're gonna start with Dan. Dan, how was your day?
Yeah, it was productive. If I have to think of a word off like the top of my head, it was productive. I got like some student loan stuff kind of like sorted out, not really, but like gonna be like getting word on that in the next like few days. And I finally got my license switched today, and I look at my license and I'm just like, I'm not a New Jersey resident anymore. So woohoo,
Oh, I
productive
forgot
day.
you actually moved over to Pennsylvania, right?
Yeah. Like
Well, I mean, you
six
kind of
months
just
ago.
abandoned us, but I mean, I guess I'll, let it
I
go.
mean, you'll see me like around Philly. If you are you going to Circus Survive on Sunday? And title fight
I'm
on
actually
Sunday?
not going over to the Circus Survive show. I'm actually going to be going with my boys in Millhouse. If anyone's in Trenton, New Jersey, or in Poughkeepsie, New York, we will be seeing you Saturday and Sunday. Come out and see Millhouse. It's going to be a fun time. That's my plug as well.
Right.
All right, so that was that. So, Alex, how was your day, man?
Well, my day was pretty boring, so I'm gonna pull in Eric and talk about a day that I had this week that was interesting. So I think it was 2 days ago. Yeah, it was 2 days ago. I went to see a show, my first show that I've been to in a while, at the Stanhope House, in Stanhope, New Jersey, and I saw Palisades, Cane Hill, and For the Fallen Dreams, and it was a really good show. Like Cane Hill is like brand new Rise Signed Records band. You know, they only like have really come out with like one song on the label so far. Haven't really come out with an album yet, so it's like I didn't really know what to expect, but they were really, really good. Like it reminded
That's
me a
good.
lot of like My Ticket Home mixed with like Sworn In kind of. Like it had like a lot of that like nu metal like stuff. And then I saw Palisades. Palisades is really good. And then I kind of got tired, so I went home before For the Fallen Dreams, unfortunately.
Oh, poor Alex North is out past his bedtime.
Yeah, I was like, my phone's on 10% battery. I'm tired. I'm gonna go home now. I've seen For the
My
Fallen
phone's on
Dreams.
10%. I don't care who's up next. I gotta go home and sleep.
I've seen For the Fallen Dreams before. It's okay.
Now, the Stanhope House is actually going to have a show on Monday, which I'm trying to get out to. And who's going to play for that, Alex?
Seaway, Tiny Moving Parts, and then like there's a bunch of other local bands that are supporting it, which I don't know the names of, but apparently they're good from what I've heard, so yeah.
So hopefully we'll have a Babe Talk meetup and we might have a on-field correspondent. I doubt it, but it's cool to think about it.
Yeah.
So we have Matt, our guest for tonight.
How's it going?
I'm doing all right, Matt. How about yourself?
I'm doing good. I'm happy to be here.
Yay, we're happy. Everyone's happy. So how was your day?
My day was good. Like my day was pretty good. Maybe I'll take the alternative route and discuss like a day earlier this week. I had an exam on Monday morning, and it was an 8:30 a.m. exam because like I'm in exams right now, and I was going into like my like mark calculator for the course, and I was mark calculating all my marks, and my exam was only worth 25% of like the course mark, and if I didn't do the
Only.
exam, I Like 25% is not a lot. Like I have three exams that are worth 45% of my final mark. So I was doing so well on the course that if I didn't go to the exam, I was only gonna like lose like 5% of my mark or 6% of my mark or well, I would lose 25%, but my mark would only drop by like not a very significant amount. I was like figuring out if I could still like pass the course, and it was saying like, oh, you'll finish with a 70 in this course if you don't go to your exam. So I was like sitting there with my roommates, like being like, okay, so I'm thinking about not going to my exam, and they're trying to convince me to go and being like, well, or you could just like go and like try your best and see what happens. And I was like, yeah, but it's like 8:30 a.m. I would so much rather sleep in than go to this exam. And, you know, I was, everyone I talked to about the exam was just kind of like, yeah, I don't know, like, I'm going to go to it and stuff, but, like, the course was just kind of bullshit, I don't know, it was just, like, some languages course that I was in that a lot of people didn't like, and I emailed my teacher and was like, oh, like, I'm really sick, I won't be coming to the exam, I'll accept the zero, and it'll be totally fine. So I woke up the next morning, and I actually got really sick. And like I was like feeling like absolute crap, and
oh, that's fantastic.
I was just like, oh my god, this is just karma. Like I was just like, oh, I'm tired, whatever, I'll sleep in. I wake up the next morning just like dying, and I'm just, oh, it was so bad. But
well, you know what your mother said, boy, you know, you don't care what you wish for.
So, oh well, it's not a big deal, it's fine. No, I mean, it is what it is, right? I feel better now, so.
No, and you did go over and took the course still? Like, you took the exam?
Sorry?
Did you still end up taking the exam?
No, I didn't. I didn't go.
Oh, you didn't end up taking
it? Oh, I did end up going. Well, I mean,
what is it? I think they say that C's get degrees. I'm pretty sure that's the saying.
Honestly, like, it's like, I'm in the first year of the program that I'm in. And it was, like, my elective for the first-year program that I'm in. And I took it, and, like, everyone I talked to was just like, yeah, like, I don't know how I feel about this course. And, like, the prof was kind of, like, weird about stuff. And so it wasn't a big deal. You know, I still passed. Everything was good. Like, you know what I mean? I didn't waste any money.
There you go.
I probably should have gone. That would have made a lot. I should have tried my best. And I suffered the consequences.
Morally, I probably should have done it, but you know.
Yeah.
You know, you hear about people all the time. Like, people tell me, one of my roommates, he was took like a chem exam that was like incredibly hard, apparently. And he told me that someone he knew last year went into the exam and wrote this, like, fuck this. Like, just fuck this. I can't do this. And just handed in the exam. Like, he knows someone that did that, and they were fine. So, like, I wasn't that guy, at least. You know, like, I didn't show up, but I wasn't like, yeah, fuck.
Yeah, you weren't so, that guy that came in and, like, made a scene.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Well.
I think back to, like, when I, because I don't go to school now. I work full-time and stuff, well, to an extent. And the only time that I remember, like, having finals and having, like, such a hell time with it was when I was in high school. And we were transitioning Spanish teachers in between finals. And that did not work out for, like, anybody. We got this substitute teacher who used to be, like, a Victoria's Secret model. And so we were like, hey, all right, it's going to be fun. But our old teacher, like, we used to just, like, ruin her life, like, every time she would come into class. The first day of our class, we actually made her cry. Well, not we. Like, I didn't, like, try and make her cry. But, like, she just, like, ended up crying. But then again, that was like her stick, because apparently my other friends had her, and like apparently every time she started to like off a new semester, she just starts sobbing, like to try and gain sympathy or something like that. So mid-semester, she quits. No, it wasn't finals, it was midterms. And we're now scrambling to get all the information that we tried to learn this year, and like no one knew anything. And my vice principal walks in, he's like, all right, we're still gonna have the midterms, so you know, be prepared. And she's going to grade them. And so she comes in. She's like, all right, what are you guys doing? We're like, midterms. We're doing our midterm stuff. What do you mean, what are we doing? She's like, oh, I don't have any information on it. So do you guys have, like, a study guide? I'm like, nah, we really don't have anything. And, like, all the kids were just, like, giving her such shit. And, like, she was, like, not having it. So I remember this one kid. His name was Forrest. And he got in the teacher's face and, like, was trying to be like, yeah, you know, it's not our fault that you guys are being real shitty teachers. It's not our fault that you guys can't do anything. And they started getting into a heated argument. And I'm like, Forrest, like, substitute teacher. We ain't got to get into all this. He's like, no, man, this bitch wants to do everything. And, like, she was like, oh, you want to call me a bitch? Yeah, well, listen to this. Your mother. And then turns around and then walks out of the class. And, like, this, we're, like, holding this kid back. Like, no, Forrest, it's not worth jail. Like, nah, I did. This is ridiculous. And because of that incident, we all didn't have to do our midterms. So, I mean, like, it ended up working out well for us.
Ollie, what school did you go to?
I went to school I won't say because I might need that school one day.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I can't tell a story like that and be like, hey, guys.
It's a school for, like, reformed criminals. Like, they make the teachers cry. They go and, you know, they go and get up in the face of, like, Victoria's Secret models. Like,
and, like, curse them out.
Like, some kind of school you're going to, you know.
It was a rough high school, man. But then again, like, it was weird because the school that I went to accepted everyone from the surrounding districts. And in my particular area, we had, like, inner city, ghetto, and then, like, suburbia white bread. And, like, that was, like, it. Like, my cafeterias were, like, self-segregated every day. The kids would just scream and yell through the halls. Like, one side was BET while the other was just, like a all the extras from Leave It to Beaver. And everyone's like, oh, was there a problem? And they're all just like, nigga, 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 nigga. It was a fucking mess. It was literally a mess. But it was hysterical. I had an interesting high school experience. But, yeah. So, we're looking at, I think, the new wave of the Warped Tour dates. Is that correct?
Warped Tour bands.
Warped Tour band. Well, yeah, the Warped Tour bands. This is now week two. Did we lose Matt? Is Matt around?
I'm still here. Can you still...
Oh, it wasn't updating on my camera. Excuse me.
Oh, yeah.
But so we are listening.
Sorry.
Oh, no. It's thank you. Tell me to go. Alex, do you have the list up? Because I have the list up if you want to announce it.
Yeah. So.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
All right. So the new bands. All right. So the new bands are Alive Like Me, Family Force 5, Bless the Fall, 100th, Lee Corey Oswald, and Trophy Eyes. And all of those bands except for Alive Like Me and Family Force 5 are all dates. So I think Alive Like Me is only for like a first couple set of dates, like maybe like the first half of the tour. And Family Force 5 is for almost all the dates, but they're missing, like, maybe, like, two or three dates in between, like, August, but...
Now, I was actually physically told that we need to touch on the subject of Family Force 5 for reasons. And, Alex, do you want to start off that topic? Because you seem well-versed in it compared to me. And maybe Dan and Matt, you guys will be able to...
I'm excited about Family Force 5 because back in the day, Family Force 5 was a very interesting band to follow because they were like kind of like the Christian version of Broken Side, but like, I don't know. They were just a very like polarizing band. They had like a lot of like weird like creative stuff that they tried to do. And they're
really?
like what? Like, I don't know, like, all the band members have, like, really seen names, like, Fatty and, like, Crumb or something, I don't know, like...
Crumb? Is it Crumb a scene name?
I don't know, like...
I remember the MySpace era,
like, they all have, like, no, like, they all Crumb. Have, like... It wasn't like they had, like, MySpace scene names, they had, like, weird names that they, like, went by as, like, their stage names.
Got you. Okay.
Yeah, and I know that for a while they kind of went dormant in, like, the mainstream, like, Warped Tour. Because they were popular. Like, they were in alt press for a while and stuff like that. But then as soon as, like, you know, a lot of the true pop punk stuff came in and, you know, a lot of, like, the Family Force 5 type stuff, you know, kind of fell to the side, they became more of, like, a band that played, like, Christian festivals and, like, Cornerstone and stuff like that, you know, when Cornerstone was still around. And, so, yeah, I just think it's very interesting that, like, this lineup has a lot of bands, you know, like, you have Family Force 5, you have Bless the Fall, who's popular back in, like, 2006 through 2009. Mm-hmm. And, hopefully, I mean, this is a sign of, like, things to come, because, like, I've heard, like, rumblings that maybe, like, Metro Station might be on. God. I've heard, like,
rumblings. Oh, Metro Station. What do you mean, oh, God? Metro Station was, like, the shit back in the day.
Yeah.
If we're talking about guilty pleasures, I would absolutely bump Kelsey, like, all the time.
Oh, my yeah, God. Yeah, I think everybody
Yo,
would.
Yo, true, same.
But, like, I don't know. I'm excited because it's a very, like, diverse lineup, because you have, like, Lee Corey Oswald, which is, like, a band that, like, only true, like, emo punks listen to. And then you have, like, 100th, which is, like, the bridge between metalcore and hardcore. Yeah. And you have Family Force 5, which is, like, crunkcore pioneers, basically. And Bless the Fall, like, seasoned metalcore veterans. And Alive Like Me, a new rise band that really hasn't been getting that much traction, but, you know. So it's a very interesting batch of bands, and it's infinitely more interesting to me than the previous lineup, where, you know, it just kind of had, like, Handguns and Neck Deep and Front Porch Step, where it's just sort of like, well, all right, yeah. I kind of expect.
But then again, because it did make it seem as if there was going to be, like, you know, the same type of, like, themed Warped Tour that typically they do seem to go for. Like, if they're going to go for one crowd, it's going to be like, all right, we're going to do Warped Tour, and it's going to be geared towards this scene. Or we're going to do it again, and it's going to be good, like, towards this scene. It seems as if this Warped Tour is going to be a showcase of other bands, like they've done in the past.
Right, right.
Yeah, so that's cool. Matt, do you have any speculations as to whether direction Warped Tour is going to go this year?
Honestly, okay, so, like, when I saw the first announcement of bands, I was like, okay, like, that makes sense. You know what I mean? Like, Neck Deep, Handguns, Front Porch Step. I mean, all of them played in the past. You know,
except Kosher Dills.
What band is that?
Alex is all on Kosher Dills all the time.
Except Kosher Dills, the Jewish rapper guy. Jersey native, Kosher Dills.
Is he really from Jersey? I remember when they had MC Lars on Warped Tour, so they always have to throw that white MC in there somewhere.
Yeah, I was just an MC Lars yesterday. It was good stuff, but
yeah, it's beautiful stuff. But so Matt, continue with what you're saying.
Yeah, I was like, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Like, boring, but makes sense. You know what I mean? Especially with, like, you know, like, Blink was like, oh, remember when we played Warped Tour in 1996? And then, like, on the same day of the announcement, and I was like, are you serious? Is Blink gonna be playing Warped Tour this year? And I mean, I didn't think they were actually gonna do it, but there was, like, that little bit of, like, hope. That I was just like, oh, please. I would, like, instantly buy tickets if Blink was playing.
That pop punk hope incense side of you, which is like, just Blink!
Exactly. And, but, like, this week, I was surprised. To be honest with you, I think I've only heard Family Force 5 maybe one time ever. Just because I always wrote them off instantly. Just their gimmick, the whole, their name, like, everything about it. I was just so like, I don't think I'm going to like this at all, so I'm not going to try. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah, they are a really ridiculous band, so.
Yeah.
It's understandable. You would write them off.
Alex, no chill. Alex just like, yeah, I mean, fuck them. They're, you know, whatever.
No, I mean, I want to see Family Force 5, but they're kind of ridiculous at the same time. Like,
I feel like
what it sounds like, they're. Go on, Matt.
I was going to say, I feel like that, like, if there's a time at Warped Tour this year, if I go, that I'm not seeing another band and they are playing, I'd be like, okay, let's go see what this is all about. You know what I mean?
Right.
But go on.
Let's see what the Family Fads is. Well, it seems like the Family Force 5 reminds me of, from the description, since I don't know them, like, Mindless Self-Indulgence.
Oh my
yeah,
God.
Yeah, I mean, a little bit like that, except with, like, less punk credibility and more, like, Christian credibility.
Like, Mindless Self-Indulgence without, like...
Yeah, like, basically, know, they're, like, yeah, basically, they're, like, all brothers, and their dad played in,
oh,
like,
really?
A really... Their dad played in, like... Well, I think that before they were Family Force 5, they were, like a wholesome, like, actual, like, Christian band that would make, like, hymns and stuff like that. Like, oh, something shit. That you would hear at your church, and not, like, Reliant K or anything like that. Like, actual, like... old people church music back when they were like kids, but then, you know, they got a little bit older and they're like, hey, you know, let's try to, you know, do some party anthems and stuff like that too at the same time. So
there you go.
Now, like, no, it's man. A gimmick it's a gimmick though, right? Like it is like a like their whole thing, that's a joke, right? Or are they serious about like with the nicknames and everything? Is that like a serious thing or is that just like this is kind of funny, let's go with it?
All right, actually I brought their names up. Their stage names. So these are their names: Fatty, Crouton, Soul Glow, Activator, Mad Daddy,
Soul Glow and Activator,
Chapstick. There's a guy named Chapstick in Family Force 5.
Crouton.
Yeah.
I just hope that's a joke. Amazing. Like I hope it's a joke. But
I, you know what? I only speculation because I have zero idea as to how that would play out. Like if they like sat down and be like, all right, we're gonna sign our contract, Crouton. It's like Crouton. So Glow and Activator. when they write the checks, oh Mr. Soul
Glow. Oh, Soul Glow Activator is one person. And he's
okay,
no longer
I
in the band.
I thought so. Okay. All
he's
right,
no longer
sense.
In the band though. He got replaced.
Of course. I say of course. That's stupid. Because I don't know if you guys know the movie Coming to America, but So Soul Glow is actually the name of like Jerry Curl ingredients that black people used to use in the movie at least. So I'm just like, oh, of course they're gonna kick the, you know, the black guy's not gonna be in the band anymore. Soul Glow Activator. Cause you know, whatever, fuck him.
But it's like a horror movie.
Just like a horror movie. It's just like, who needs black people in a horror movie? We need someone to murder first to get the
right.
But Dan, what are your speculations for this year's Warped Tour?
I have a feeling it's going to be, like, a mix. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know how last year was, like, newcomers in, like, the Warped Tour scene, and then there were, like, some more, like, well-known bands, like Saves the Day, Bayside, like, bands in that scene. I'm feeling it's going to be like that.
That makes sense. That's valuable. Okay.
I just realized I never actually said what I speculated. I just realized.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry, Matt.
No, it's totally cool. I'm just a piece of shit anyways. Like, whatever. I don't go to my exams. I don't get listened to.
I don't listen to the show. I'm actually on. I don't. God damn, Matt. Get your life together.
No, but I think it'll be cool. I think that there'll be some bands playing this year that I wouldn't expect to play at all. Like, Hundreds, I did not expect to play whatsoever. Like, I know that they're up and coming, I know they're very relevant right now, but, like, I'm from Hamilton, Ontario, which is the same place that Counterparts is from, and, okay. I following them for a long time, I'm pretty sure at least I've heard them say, like, they would never play Warped Tour, and I always, like, Hundreds and Counterparts kind of being bands that have always toured together, it seems like, and I know that know each other, I always assumed Hundreds was going to be one of those bands that's just like, yeah, fuck this, I'm not down with this, you know what I mean? And, but I mean, clearly that has changed, and I'm really excited about Trophy Eyes, because I've never seen them before, and I know they're coming over from Australia, and I think that'd be, like, that's sick for them, especially since they just signed to Hopeless, right? So, like...
Yeah. And Hundredth is also signed to Hopeless too.
Oh, true. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, Trophy Eyes is really good though. Like, they're one of my favorite bands of like that sort of melodic hardcore, pop punk crossover genre. You know.
Yeah, I feel like this year, Warped Tour will kind of have more of like a, I wouldn't say like heavier, but not heavier in the way of like risecore bands, but heavier in the way of like more melodic hardcore, more like bands that are kind of like have more of like an edgier sound to them, I guess, that aren't on Rise Records. You know what I mean? It seems like it's always
ones
been a lot
that
like
will
Memphis.
Like, you know, kill the 14-year-olds when they play.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
But like hard, basically hardcore core, which is like the Ghost Inside, Stick to Your Guns,
hardcore core,
core core.
I actually didn't know that was a thing, but it makes sense.
Yeah, I think the guys over at Stuffy Will Hate made up that term.
That sounds about right. That actually sounds absolutely right. I'm probably going to send an Aaron a message and be like, yo. But so what I always found interesting was when bands say that they're never going to play Warped Tour. Now, was there, with Counterparts, is there a reason as to why they said that? Because I remember Balancing Composure, Touche and War.
Wait, no, not Citizen. I'm thinking of...
I'm like, wait, what? I'm like, I'm pretty sure, like, Citizen would be one of the first... Oh, no, A, they already have played.
Yeah. Yeah, I was thinking of somebody else for some reason. Yeah, Touche Amore.
Yeah, no, yeah, Touche Amore. Touche Amore was one of those bands that just said, yeah, we're never going to play Warped Tour. And it escapes me right now as to why they said, and I'm actually very upset, but Matt, do you remember why Counterparts actually said that they're never going to play Warped Tour?
Honestly, I'm not, don't for sure quote me on that. I'm like pretty sure I read that.
Well, I'm
going to
use you as a main source on our new website when we actually launch it, so.
True.
Counterpart says they'll never play Warped Tour.
Freaking news. Matt, I'll finally see. It's going to be on now, property of Zach in the morning.
I'm like pretty sure I've read that before, like on maybe like Brendan's Twitter or something along those lines. And, honestly, I just think it's like, I like, those guys are from where, like, where I'm from and stuff like that. I don't know them. I have the utmost respect for that band and everything like that, but I feel like they're just kind of not about it. They're just not about all those, like, about bands getting big based off of, like, shitty things and, like, just, like, bands that just, like, you know, they go on Rise and they sound like everything else before and they play Warped Tour, get huge and get all these fangirls, and I think they're just, like, not about that, you know? It just seems like seems what it's like to me, and I know that like that's what Warped Tour has been like in the past. You know, like the first year I went to Warped Tour, I think the first band I saw of the day was Asking Alexandria. You know what I mean? And then the people that I was with throughout the day, they saw like Devil Wears Prada and like just all these different bands that are kind of like I don't know, like bands that like I know that well, those aren't really Risecore bands, but like bands that just kind of have this like. I guess you could say, like to me at least, have this like kind of like stigma in a way. I guess I don't know, like bands that people seem to like make fun of a lot, like Asking Alexandria and stuff like that, or like bands that have like used to have like neon T-shirts with all these like crazy different designs on it and shit. You know?
Yeah, like you have like the monsters and the animals,
gory
and stuff.
And it seems like they just like weren't about it, you know. And I'm pretty sure, at least I don't know if it's different now. I mean, like. Counterparts is arguably like the biggest like hardcore band right now, or at least the most relevant in my opinion, you know. And it might be different now that they've gotten bigger, because this probably was a long time ago. But it seemed before that they were just kind of like, yeah, fuck that, like that's just stupid to us, we're not gonna do that, we're not just gonna sell out to that level and just like jump on Warped Tour any opportunity, you know. So
now that's a word that I can see being used when it comes to the Warped Tour circuit, is being selling out.
Yeah.
Dan, do you think that bands actually do end up selling out when they hit the Warped Tour circuit, or do you think that it's just another outlet for bands to perform where people sometimes just aren't able to go?
It can go one of two ways. I see Warped Tour as like, it's like, yeah, it's a good tool. Help and you know get like more of like your fan base out there. It's like a big showcase and all that, but like I feel as if the bands themselves let the fame kind of like get to their heads in a way, then that's when they start to sell out.
All right, I guess that does end up making sense. Now, do you think that bands like Touche Amore, who probably feel the same way that Counterparts do, still view it like even them as people, like still not wanting to do the Warped Tour circuit, like because I would feel as if bands would be able to like, you know, be themselves, stay to themselves,
or like
you know, stand to their friends,
tour, like,
yeah,
no matter what. But like I can understand why Touche like doesn't want to be a part of like that whole scene though, and it kind of like. I don't know. It's like bands just don't want to like. I guess some bands just like don't want to fall into that like. I feel like some bands are like afraid to like fall into like to be like a Warped Tour band and have like all that kind of like attention. Like people just want to. Like some bands just feel like want to have like more intimate like scenes and shows. That's how I see it. Just like some bands just want to do like their business differently.
Yeah, makes sense. Alex, you got it. Ooh, Matt, yeah.
Yeah, well, I was just going to say, like, I feel like the whole intimacy thing is actually a big part of it. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like bands do like that, being able to, like, be right up there with their fans and get in their faces and that whole kind of, like, there's, like, that raw energy about, like, intimacy when you play, like, small club shows, especially when you're a big band, you know? And and I feel like bands do like that, like, how personal like playing small clubs are and how they can do that on like tours like that, or whereas like Warped Tour, like there's like you barricade like gap stage, you know what I mean? And and similar to like what Dan was saying about like the whole like selling out thing, I feel like they're like, I was saying this about like Asking Alexandria, for example, is a band I feel kind of has like a bit of like a stigma to it, in the sense that like they kind of have like this following of like kind of like annoying, not annoying, but like fangirls that are like, oh, like Warped Tour, like that, like Warped Tour is the greatest thing ever, you know, like people that like have Warped Tour as their location on Twitter and stuff like that, or like Catch Me in the Pit, just like, you know what I mean, like girls with like teased hair that like are stuck in 2011 kind of thing.
with like a million like bracelets from like Hot Topic, and exactly. are like I love like Mitch Lucker and Kellen Quinn and
Vic Fuentes.
Yeah. And like kind of like, yeah, Hot Topic girls, you know, alternative press Hot Topic girls, you know, girls that they're every band they love is on Rise Records, and they love anything that has like screaming and like pretty boys. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think that like there's that kind of like Warped Tour, at least not so much anymore. I feel like that's kind of changing, had that like kind of like, I guess you could say, stigma about the bands that would play it, that were like, it was bands like that, and you were gonna get a following like that, and the crowd like that, and the people that were gonna come see you were like that. And I think that like, to some people, you know, they like saw it as more like, we want to be respected, we don't want to just take that easy way out and just fall into like this like, I guess you could say like commercialism kind of thing, like, oh, like we can just do this and we'll make a lot of money selling t-shirts and we'll do this, and it makes it not about like the music, or makes it not about like the intimacy of playing venues and going on tour, and it's kind of just all about this like glitz, like glamour and stuff like that, you know, that it's just kind of like comes with it, you know. So I don't know. I feel like that's part of it. I feel like that's kind of where Touche is coming from on it, at least. I don't know. There could be a lot more like personal things there, but I feel like at least in the past, Warped Tour has always kind of been this like, you know, it's a day for 16-year-old girls. Like, that's what it is to me. I've seen a lot of great bands, and I've had a couple like awful Warped Tour experiences because of like weather and things like that. But like, I went last year into the Toronto Warped Tour that I didn't plan on going, and then I ended up going, and it was like a beautiful day. I saw like a bunch of great bands, and it honestly was like a great time. But when I've been in the past, it's like, wow, this is just a lot of like young girls with makeup running down their face and their hair completely fucked up from like all the rain and everyone pushing them and like this whole thing, you know? So I feel like that's where like the kind of like the selling out thing comes from, because it's like, yeah, like that might be what it is. And to me, I don't have a problem with that. Like, bands, do what you're going to do. You know, who cares if you're growing, if you have a fan base, sick, that's all that matters to me. But I feel like bands are kind of like, see that as like a negative kind of thing, you know?
Makes sense. And now, do you think that there will come a point in time which that stigma might be lifted? Like, as I was saying, like, the bands that are being released now seem a little bit more diversified, and do you think that if Warped Tour were to, like, you know, keep it up for the next, I don't know, let's say next three tours, do you think that bands like Touche, More, and Counterparts would have a different opinion on it if they were to keep diversifying the field, or if they just stick to the same old ways, they're just gonna be like, nope, forever giving up?
I think it's definitely changing. I think there's a definite like difference about it. I mean, with Hundreds playing this year, that's a big thing. And I don't even know, Counterparts could be scheduled to play Warped Tour this year, and I could be lying to you this entire time, and none of this even matters, you know. But like, I think it is changing. I think there's a definite like difference with it. You know, I think a big part of this too is that like, you know, bands like Sleeping with Sirens, Memphis Mayfire, and bands that have played Warped Tour in the past used to be like I guess you could say like the most relevant thing, especially on like the internet and Tumblr and all those and all of social media. That's what I heard about all the time. And I think with that's changing into more bands like Neck Deep and Real Friends and all those bands. And I think that's kind of like, it's less about like, it's kind of like more, it's like less about like I guess there's a lot of like pretty boys in those other bands, and not so much in these current upcoming bands, I guess. And I think it's like slowly changing with the like popularity and the relevancy of bands like Counterparts becoming incredibly more relevant, bands like Real Friends becoming more relevant, 100th, all those bands, you know, in some ways, it's kind of lame because I do feel like there's a lot of people out there that pretend to like those bands. It doesn't matter to me, but there are people that kind of see it, they think it looks cool, and they want to be a part of it, so they do it, and that's where those band people, those are the people that are going to go to Warped Tour. And with that, like, kind of changing, like, with the whole, like, materialism thing, like, changing with it, like, how it's, like, gone from being, like liking pretty boy bands to liking these, like, edgy, cool, sad bands, that's what's changing for Warped Tour, and bands like Counterparts, and, I mean, probably not Touche, because they've expressed how much they dislike it, will play in the future, you know?
Right.
So
I think that there's definitely, like, you're seeing a little bit, like, and I mean, I don't mean to say this as, like, saying, like, Sleeping with Sirens, like, listening to Sleeping with Sirens is, like, immature or whatever, but you're sort of seeing, like, with, like, these Tumblr girls, you're sort of seeing them, like, grow up a little bit, because, like, these girls who had Tumblrs maybe, like, a year or two ago that, you know, were, like, reblogging gifs of, like, you know, funny Kellen Quinn antics at, like, you know, on tour that they posted on YouTube or something.
Yeah.
You know, they went from that to posting gifs of, you know, Ben Barlow on stage. And I think it's because, you know, that they personally, as they got older, they were like, oh, you know.
That's like supporting the argument that scene is like an entry level drug to pop punk, and I still don't think that's a thing.
Oh no, it's definitely a thing.
I'm skeptical to believe
I mean, a year ago, like there are a bunch of kids who are into pop punk who were into, like, you know, Rise Core and stuff like that, like, a year or two ago, and I'm not
a gateway drug to hardcore.
And I'm not, and I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with that. Like, hey, by all means, you know, I like a lot of, like, scene bands. I like a lot of pop punk bands. I like a lot of hardcore bands. You know, they're all really cool genres, and they all have their perks, and they all have their value by listening to them. But, you know, there is a correlation in terms of, like, the fan bases to each and how they're, like, you know, how sometimes they act as, like, building blocks on one another, you know?
And I think, like, just touching on what Alex said, I think it definitely is, like, a gateway thing. I feel like everyone, a lot of people I know at least, that were, like, into Mice and Men, into Sleeping with Sirens, whatever, they, like, you know, they got Tumblr accounts, thought it was cool, and then they started seeing, like, Real Friends, and they were like, oh, I'm sad too, and, like, I relate to this, you know what I mean? And, like, oh, this band speaks to me and everything. And at the end of the day, it's, like, whatever gets you into these bands, like, cool, that's cool with me. I don't want to see my favorite bands break up because they didn't have enough fans that are 14-year-old girls and will buy their shirts. You know what I mean? Like, that would bum me out, these bands breaking up before their time. And, you know, I think that those bands see, like, you see, like, bands like Sleeping with Sirens, Memphis May Fire, they get Tumblr accounts, and then they see Real Friends, they see Neck Deep, they see those things, and they see those bands repping, like, heavier bands, and then they get into the heavier bands because their favorite bands like those bands. You know what I mean? It's kind of like it's just each step, like, goes there, you know? And I think actually that's the cool thing, though, about Warped Tour, with it changing, is that those bands on Warped Tour, like, you know, like the Rise Core and Seed bands that, you know, they started, like, becoming, I guess you could say, like, it seems like they started repping the pop punk bands who were up the hardcore bands, and a big part of that you can see in Warped Tour is that, like, those bands started becoming more relevant via Warped Tour, and then those bands would rep the pop punk bands, and they start playing Warped Tour because that's what's relevant, because the other bands rep them, or because they saw them on Tumblr or whatever, and now it's, like, the hardcore thing, or whatever the next thing is, like, soft grunge is going to become even more relevant, because they're all boys, because they all hung out when they played Warped Tour together, you know, and that's what the changing thing is, you know, and it's, like the dude from, like, Moths to Flames is on the Real Friends record, you know, and I wouldn't say they're, like, a Rise Core band, but I feel like a lot of the people that I know that like them are females, they're young, and it is what it is, doesn't matter to me, but it's just, I feel like that's, like, the continuing, like, the steps with it, you know, and it just kind of seems how it's, like, going, and I really hope that it, in some ways I hope it continues, because all it's doing is making bands that I like play, like, get way bigger and do more and more things, you know, but I think it's funny how like you can see it happening with people, just from like let alone bands they like repping another band, that they're getting all of a sudden getting into different genres, you know?
Right.
So,
and you're seeing a lot of mixed genre lineups lately. I've been noticing, like, I mean, especially this comes on the heels of the recently announced Newfound Glory, Turnstile, Turnover, yeah, and This Wild Life tour. Like that is a really diverse lineup and stuff. Just like a that
bit. Yeah.
Yeah, and like sometimes, you know, like you'll maybe have like Let Live playing with, you know, a band that, you know, that is more like scene, and then you'll have Let Live playing with a band that's more like hardcore. Like I think it's an interesting time that it is within the realm of possibility that you can have like that. I could foresee like Backtrack and like Attila playing on like the same stage at Warped Tour, like back to back.
Oh, I'd cry.
Yeah, I could foresee that. I mean, you already had Terror on the same stage, yeah, as Attila, so, you know.
Yeah, it, that's very true.
Yeah, so I'm saying, you know, but like that's the way that, you know, things are headed, and it definitely causes, you know, a lot of very interesting connections between people and, you know, bands and like more, you know, like sort of like how Matt was saying, people in more like scene bands are like, you know, sort of becoming friends with more like, I don't really want to say like more like respected or like, you know, but bands that have like a sense of like credibility that these other bands don't in like certain music circles and stuff like that, like, you know. And then, you know, you'll have you know, like Issues, I think, is the biggest thing. Like, you have like the dude from Issues, the drummer from Issues filled in for the drummer for State Champs on Warped Tour for one date last year, and I think Issues and State Champs might be going on tour together or something. And then, what? Yeah,
really,
yeah, and then crazy. Also, yeah, and then also Issues on they like did like acoustic re-recordings of like a bunch of songs, and on one of the songs they have Ben Barlow of Neck Deep on it, you know. So, and yeah, I mean. Yeah, and then you also have, like, you know, Tyler Carter wearing nails, repping nails on his, you know, shirt, and you have the DJ dude in, like, a really, like, hardcore band and Amoria Brooded and stuff, you know, it's just, it's crazy, you know?
For sure.
Yeah.
Now, the last question we'll ask before we start to get towards the interview, since apparently there's a direct correlation between the trends. Because that's pretty much what it is. Whatever scene seems to trend on Tumblr eventually spills its way over to Warped Tour. How much longer before we actually see the starter packs that everyone keeps tweeting out actually hit stores?
Man, okay.
It's like you'll end up seeing the store so far, and then the flannels, the khakis, then the Vans.
I was totally not expecting that end of that question.
starter pack.
A starter. Oh yeah. I mean, like, because it would make sense. Amazon would have a deal with Tumblr, and it's like, oh shit, all these kids are wearing this.
And then you'll have
like,
a.
Hey, you also might like.
It'll be like Pokemon cards. Like, you'll have like the story so far. You'll have like the story so far starter pack, and you'll have like
the booster packs. Oh, yeah, absolutely!
And you'll have everything you need to get started. But then, like, you'll have like the booster packs where it'll have like more like advanced stuff. Where like maybe you'll get like a nails like beanie or something in it, and then, or like
the sworn in noose.
This one in news. They all have different rarities depending on like,
Backtrack brass knuckles.
And you're like, whoa, this will give me so much cred.
This will give me so much more cred in streets. What was it? God damn, I'm so mad at myself. Not Attila gloves. The Muir fingerless gloves.
Yeah, the boxing gloves. The Muir boxing gloves.
Yeah, MMA gloves. But yeah, yep. So that was a good discussion. Yeah, that was a joke question. Yeah, I wasn't.
Matt honestly, though, it's like, It's not gonna be Amazon. It's gonna be Hot Topic. Hot Topic is gonna like brand it in some way. They'll call it the Hot Topic starter packs or something, and you'll get like a T-shirt off their wall and like a pair of jeans and like a snapback with it or something. You know,
I could see that happening. That's exactly scarily why enough.
They had hired me. I mean, like I work this, so I have to be like, hey, you know, hey, I follow you on to Tumblr, so I know exactly what you want. Be like, oh, hey, you're a pop-up nigga. Be like, yeah, I know. But so anyway, we're gonna jump our way into the interview before I lose my job. For the rest, well, we're gonna go. It's gonna go me. We'll go Alex, and then we'll go Dan. Does that sound good for you guys?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. So Matt, for the record, could you say who you are, your position in the band, and what band you play in?
I'm Matt. I sing in an Ontario band called Fighting Season.
And what genre would you say did you guys fall into?
We are a pop-punk band. Definitely a pop-punk band. A true pop-punk band. For those people that know that.
True. I mean, after listening to you guys, I can absolutely agree with that. Where would you guys say would be the story behind Fighting Season?
It's a long story that I'm just going to make it, like, really short. When I was, like 3-4 years ago, I was like starting my like first band with people, whatever, kind of just getting into music. I was like friends with a bunch of dudes, and we kind of started this band that was essentially the like first, like, I guess you could say, like the first like going of Fighting Season. We like, that was the name that I actually ended up coming up with, and we're like, okay, we'll call ourselves Fighting Season. We were like a band for maybe 2 months. We played one show, we had 3 songs, and then it just never went anywhere, and people left, and that was whatever. And then I was doing my own acoustic thing for a little bit, and I was on, there's like, you guys have Craigslist, and we have Kijiji in Canada. I don't know, I don't think that's a thing in the States. It's called Kijiji, and essentially it's like Craigslist. It's like all like personal listings and stuff. And I was like on there one day, just like kind of going through it, and they have like musicians wanted, that's like on one of the things. And sometimes I go through it because people can actually post like really funny things or like really ridiculous, like they're looking for really specific people. And I was going through it, and I found these dudes from a place called Brampton, which is about an hour north of me, and they're looking for like a bass player in their band, and they're listing off all these bands that I really liked, like Turnover and all these different bands that I'm like really into. And I was like, I haven't been in a band for a while, like I'll message them. So I ended up talking with them a bit, whatever, and I ended up like talking with them, and I was like, hey, like I know you guys look for a bass player, but actually like I sing and stuff. And I joined the band, and they were like, okay, cool, actually like we're like, it just ended up, like, we switched members around kind of thing, and then we started jamming, everything was good, I'm like, all right, let's do the band, we'll, like, we'll do this, you know, and we were trying to come up with names, and I had, like, originally, like, the original Fighting Season, like, Facebook page, whatever, that, like, barely had any likes, like, no one really paid attention to it, no one cared, and I was like, well, you know, I used to be in this band a long time ago, that never really went anywhere, but still, like, I still wanted to do it, you know. And I was like, well, why don't we just do that? Like, I still like the name. We never did anything. We weren't really a band. So, like, it's kind of like this, like, the reincarnation of Fighting Season came in November 2012 because of a Kijiji ad on the internet. And that's where we're at now, you know?
A Fighting Season revival. How about that?
Pretty much.
Alex, you have your question to set?
Yeah. So, what do you think really distinguishes Fighting Season from a lot of bands in the pop-punk genre? Because you know, bands in the pop-punk genre that have a tendency to, you know, have a very similar sound to one another. Like, what makes Fighting Season stand out in, you know, a sea of, like, you know, bands that are kind of, you know, all about, you know, gruff vocals and stuff like that, you know?
Honestly, I'm like, being completely honest, nothing at all. Not in like a bad way, not in the way that we're like, oh, we're just copying other bands and we're just doing all these things. I think a lot of bands that we've listened to over time have kind of like changed sounds a lot. And I think that like pop punk music right now, besides bands like, there's like Neck Deep and Real Friends and like Handguns, you know, but besides like, I feel like a lot of bands are kind of changing from one genre to another. You know, like Turnover was a pop punk band, and now they're kind of like a softer, like indie-ish type emo band. You know, right. And I think what distinguishes us is that we're just trying to keep doing what we do. You know, like the only thing about us that we try to do is write music that's like honest to us, music that we like feel, music that is just like we listen to it and it makes us like. I guess feel something at the end of the day, you know? And I guess that's the thing, is that we're not trying to be like a gimmicky band. We're not trying to be like, oh, we'll do this and everyone will like this. That's why we're going to do it sort of thing, you know? Whereas I feel like there are bands out there that are currently doing that, or like they're kind of getting like, you know, like soft grunge or whatever, whatever right. else is new right now. And I don't know. I think that's what it is that maybe that's what sets us apart, that we just literally just do this because we want to do it and because we love the music we're writing and everything, and we're not like trying to be someone else and we're not trying to do all those things. And I'd like to think that, like, you know, in some ways, like, the music we're writing is like pretty good, and maybe that's what sets us apart, because there's a lot of pop punk bands coming out right now that are just kind of like, I listen to it, I'm like, oh, this is pretty good, but it's you know, I can name off like five things about this that I can just like, that just like are so, like, whatever, you know what I mean? So
yeah, like when I don't know. Death, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I don't think that, I think with our new EP, like our first EP, we were kind of one of those bands that like, this is just completely generic, completely everything about it is completely generic. And I think that maybe with our new EP, we do have like some other stuff that we tried to do with it, and we're writing a lot of music that's actually like not different, but like we're just trying to like experiment with like other music that we like. And I think maybe that's what like kind of sets us apart. I don't know. It's a hard question to answer, because like essentially the thing is that we are a generic pop punk band, and I am completely willing to admit that we are what we are. We sound like a lot of other bands that are out there right now, and I don't think anything distinguishes about us, but I think we're not trying to distinguish ourselves as like different, you know. We're not trying to be a different band than anyone else. We're just writing music that we love and music that we feel, and that's all that ever mattered to us was honesty in the music, and writing the music that we love. And if it sounds like other bands, then it sounds like other bands, but, you know, it's up to you to hear it and take what you will from it, you know? I saw Real Friends really recently, and I used to absolutely love that band. Like, they were one of my favorite bands a long time ago, and I heard the new record, and I was kind of disappointed. And I saw them recently, and, like, they had, like, these, like, spoken word talking parts in between songs as, like, part of their, like, stage, like, as, like, in between songs, they would, like, they'd go off stage, or they'd be like doing other things, and like there'd be spoken word just playing, like pre-recorded spoken word, and I just started I really disliked it. I really thought that it was just like, I feel like this band is trying so hard to be like a sad band, you know. They're trying so hard to impress all these people and be like, you know, in some ways, kind of what we said before about the whole like Tumblr, you know. And I guess that's the thing about that we're trying to do, is just we just don't want to be one of those bands. We don't want to be a band that like falls into something. We don't want to be a band that's trying to impress anyone. We're just doing it for ourselves. And if you like it, that's sick. But that's what we love. We appreciate all the support we can get, you know. But I don't think there is really anything that makes us sound different than any other band, really. Like, you know, maybe the honesty. You know, it's up to people listening to decide what they feel about it, you know.
Right. Yeah, I totally feel everything that you're saying.
Dan?
So Matt, what bands like do you like take influence from when like what are like your influences when it comes to like writing music?
So when we're like writing music, it ends up being like me and our drummer a lot, just like writing ourselves, just the two of us kind of thing. I don't play guitar in my band, but like I like to like write a lot of the songs. And like whenever we're jamming, like I kind of prefer to play an instrument and just jam along than like singing and stuff. I feel like when it comes to like instrumentally, I guess you could say, like, I guess I don't even know. It's hard to say what I listen to instrumentally that influences me. But when it comes to just like writing songs, like I think like I will listen to bands like Real Friends. I will listen to like Neck Deep. I will listen to like Handguns. The Wonder Years are my like favorite band of all time, and I know that a million and a half people feel that way, but like they're just like, they are my favorite band of all time. I'm driving down from Canada to Philadelphia to that Upside show.
Oh, no way!
In February. Really? Yeah. Yeah.
Nice, what day?
So, the Upside's one on the Friday.
Oh, cool. We have to stop the show. Go on, let's continue.
We may have to meet up.
Okay, I'm there.
Yes. A bunch of us are actually going to get a room, and we'll have a room, and we're all going to go on different dates. But that's neither here nor there. You can continue. I do apologize.
Yeah. So, like, the Wonder Years, and, like, I guess it is, like, current pop-up against Real Friends, the Wonder Years, Neck Deep, Handguns. I'm really into Turnover. I've been listening to a lot of a band called Bad Luck lately. They're from Florida. I'm sure you guys have heard of them. They're super good. I also listen to a lot of like Silverstein and like From First to Last. And I just try, I guess the thing is now is that when we came to writing this new EP that we just put out, I started listening to every band that I could think of and just trying to draw inspiration from absolutely anything that I like, you know? And especially with like, we're currently already writing new music. The EP just came out, but we're already trying to write more music and just trying to get more and more out. Like, I think we've been like experimenting. Like, our one guitar player, he's really into like John Mayer and stuff like that. And we've been listening to absolutely everything we can, trying to draw inspiration. Our biggest influence, I would say, is like State Champs, The Wonder Years, Knuckle Puck, and Real Friends, you know, which is a pretty standard answer. But I think when we draw influences, we do it from like wherever we can and listen to every kind of type of band that we like and just be like, hey, this is cool, like, you know, like, let's see what we can do. And we just write how, where it goes, you know, we just let the songs flow and like let them come, you know what I mean? So
Now you're saying that you feel as if like, you know, it's like a standard answer to say like, you know, you're drawing from these other bands, but it seems to be working out for you, and especially with the content you guys are putting out, like with your latest EP that you guys have put out, Weathered, it seemed pretty heavy. Now, like, when you take those influences that you had compared to your writing, where do you, that I had two different points that just like slipped away from myself, but the main question is that like the stories that are behind your songs, you make it work within the genre. Now, what are the stories that go behind your writing that you're able to fit in with the rest of the pop punk that you have studied?
Well, I guess lyrically, like, I just try to write from a place, like I said before, like, honesty is such a big part of music to me. And I feel like when I listen to bands that are truly, like, truly saying how they feel, I find myself being able to connect to them more and more, you know? And that's what I liked about Old Real Friends. I felt that they were being incredibly honest with their lyrics, and I feel like to this point now where like they're trying to be so poetic and so deep that I don't feel like it's truly like a way they feel or a way they see things. And I guess like lyrically, you know, a lot of the stories just come from just like just personal experience, as simple as that, you know. I went through a bad breakup last year. We released a song called Heights in December of last year, and me and that girl no longer together went through like a bad breakup, and I spent a lot of time after that like thinking about the kind of person that I am, the kind of person that I wanted to be, and the where I wanted to be spending my time, where I wanted to be putting my efforts, and where I was going. And I guess what I came to realize is that everything I used to think about or everything I knew in the past, like, literally didn't matter at all, and that I actually didn't know anything about myself or my life or what I was doing, and that I had all these ideas in my head of what I was, of everything, and that I absolutely had no clue. And when it came to writing the EP, I tried to, I search for the, just how I was feeling in those moments, you know, try to, like, put a lot of, like, all my negative thoughts, all the negative things that were going on, and try to put them into lyrics and fit them into songs, you know, and try to just be, say as much as I can and make it so that I truly feel, I truly, like, these lyrics truly mean something to me, they truly matter to me, you know, and I guess that's where it kind of comes from. Like, I don't really have a lot of, like, specific stories. Our one song, Temple, is about, is, like, kind of how is an interpretation on a situation that my buddy was going through with, like, this girl he was dating for a year, and then, like, she was just, like, kind of, like, not the greatest to him, and they broke up, and he was telling me about it one night, and, like, we had, like, had a super long talk about it, and that song was kind of, like, an interpretation of how he was feeling and how I related it to my own feelings. But the rest of it is just kind of, like, I guess it all stems from a year of me realizing that I'm not doing anything that I should be doing, that I need to, like, get my shit together and be the person who I want to be, or else I'm not going to get anywhere, and I'm going to be 19, living at home, not doing the things that I want to be doing, and just like, frustrated and upset, like I feel like a lot of people are, because they didn't do the things they wanted to do, or they let things get in the way. And I guess this EP is a big part, is that I had a lot of things that would got in the way in the past of how I was feeling, and, like, kind of, like, I just, like push people away and be shitty and, like, whatever. And with this new EP is that, like, that was a big, like, step for letting those feelings out, and that's how the songs kind of came out of it, you know? So.
That's cool. And especially with honesty and, like, you know, writing from real places. That's, it's the best way to, you know.
Exactly.
Oh, yes. Absolutely, go on, Matt.
Yeah. No, I don't want to say. I would just ramble about the same thing over and over again.
Right.
I kind of seem to do that.
All right, so my question is that you said that there was a previous incarnation of Fighting Season before this. What do you think made this incarnation of Fighting Season work and the other one not?
I think a big part was, like, personalities and level of maturity and a lot of things that didn't work in the past. You know, I kind of always was, like, looking for band members and, like, actively looking and just kind of checking it out. And the first time around, there's just people that had ideas of what they wanted to do, but egos clashed, things didn't work, people were immature, and honestly, I was young, I was like 15, 16, so I was like immature, and I had an idea of what I wanted to do, and I think that none of us really went about it the right way, and that band just fizzled, you know, it just kind of just dissolved, you know what I mean? And with the new band, it's like, I guess I was just that much older, everyone was just that much more on board. And I think a big part of this too is that with the band currently is that, like, we have a big understanding of, like, like how a band needs to be run, and that, like, you can't have everyone can't have egos. You kind of have to take one for the team. You got to just go with it and discuss things in, like, a proper way and be, like, you know, considerate to each other. And I think that wasn't happening a lot. And I think that's the thing that happens to a lot of bands, that people can be dicks when they don't get their way and they kind of, like, throw fits and stuff like that. And I feel like we're all on this similar page that, like, you know, bands have roles, bands have these things that need to be done. So, like, someone has to lead. You can't have a bunch of people doing everything or else you're all going to get fucked. You know, people have to kind of, like, take their place and just go with it and enjoy it and be considerate to each other. And I think that's, like, why it didn't work the first time, because that wasn't happening at all, and we were all young and immature. And now it's like the lineup we currently have, and with all the dudes in my band, like, I feel like we all just get along super well. And, you know, if someone doesn't want to do something, or, you know, someone doesn't want to do something and four other people want to do it, then they're like, all right, you know what, fuck it, like, let's just do it, you know, and just go with it. And I think that's why it didn't work the first time, but that's why it's working now. And I just feel like we're just all, like, essentially just we're all on the same page. And that doesn't happen always, you know. That's why a lot of bands kind of seem to break up and just a lot of unnecessary drama happens when you're in a band. Right, a lot of unnecessary drama.
It's a chemistry
drama.
Thing.
Exactly. So I guess that's what it is. It's chemistry. That's why it didn't work the first time, and that's why it's working now. And if the people that were in the band the first time might hear this, I hope you know that I still have respect for you as the people.
Aw, there you go.
So.
Dan.
Okay, so Matt, I was looking at the band's Facebook, like, seeing the About section, and I noticed that you guys are endorsed by City to City Apparel.
Yes.
How did you guys manage to swing that? All right, repping, like,
yeah.
Like, how'd you get to know, like, Dan Axelson, and how'd City to City come to Canada?
okay, so I guess, like, I saw the Facebook page a long time ago, or like whenever they kind of like launched their first order of stuff, like in summer of 2012, I believe it was. And I looked the page, and we literally started the band in November of 2012, and I saw them like literally around right around the same time post like, oh, we're looking for bands to endorse, looking for bands to like do it or whatever. And immediately I sent like Dan an email. I was like, hey, like we're a band that hasn't been announced yet. Like we are still writing songs. We have like a plan in place for how we want to record and release them and like kind of like come out swinging. And I emailed them, and then I ended up adding Dan on Facebook and talking to him like a lot. And we like just kind of like hit it off. And I think a big part was like we really pushed, like we were like trying to get people like their page, and like when we would post like the like links like, hey, check out City Apparel, we ended up getting like people that I had on my Facebook that I didn't talk to were like, oh shit, this is cool, and ordering stuff. Like I remember Dan texting me being like, do you know who this guy is? I was like, yeah, I went to elementary school with him, I haven't talked to him in 5 years. He's like, yeah, we just placed an order for City to City. I was like, oh, that's sick. And I guess that's what it was. They were looking for bands to endorse, and then I ended up getting into contact with them, and we kind of hit it off, and he liked what we were doing, and we liked what they were doing. They were growing as a brand, we were growing as a band, and that's how we ended up with the endorsement. We were like one of the first bands they ended up endorsing, and it's been a great working relationship since then. Whenever Dan's in Canada, I always find time to go like hang out with them. And it's cool. It's cool having like from day one those guys supported us, because like we supported them, and I think that's a big thing, is that they want to support bands that support them, and they want to support local music because I know they're musicians themselves, and that's how we got, I guess that's how we got in contact, just through connecting and just things working out, you know. So
yeah. Have you heard like any of the other bands that are also endorsed by City of City?
I have heard some of them. I honestly should listen to them more. I know Me Versus I, and I know The Artwork Of, because those are two bands that like I guess Dan works like super closely with.
He works really close with The Artwork Of and Me Versus I. They're both really, really good. They're all really good guys, and like they all play like really good music.
Yeah, and like that's the thing too, is that I checked them out. Like I definitely, when we got like when we announced everything, and we were announced that we were like on the endorsement and everything like that, we were obviously psyched, and I checked out all the bands then. I know that some bands have come in like come with the brand now, and I don't know all of them, but like I definitely have heard Me Versus I and The Artwork Of, and I was definitely impressed with both of them. I haven't listened to them in a while. But, like, I remember listening to it and being like, wow, this is, like, these bands are, like, legit. They're actually doing things. This is cool that we are part of something with these bands, you know? So, and I know they're all from New Jersey, like, New Jersey, New York kind of area, too, so.
South Jersey, more or less.
Yeah. So.
You know, I was thinking that we had we're coming on a show, but we don't, and I'm a dirty liar, and I'm not going to say it, but we should get them on. Back to, you know, Matt of Fighting Season. You guys are touring stuff, correct?
Sorry, say that again?
You guys are like a touring band. You guys have ended up going on tour before.
We just announced a couple of dates that we're doing at the end of January, or at the end of December, sorry. I wouldn't really say it's like a tour. It was, like, literally it says on the shows, like, it's winter, so it's we're playing shows. Week.
Yeah.
and I remember like we were designing the poster, and the guy Scott Jones, who designs just like our posters like as of lately, he was like, do you want me to like call it like a winter tour, or what do you want me to call it? And I was like, man, just like just say it's winter, so we're playing shows, because that's all it is, you know. But yeah, we toured through Ontario back in August. We just did pretty much all of Ontario over the course of like 10 days, which was like really fun. And that was a tour that like I had actually booked myself that ended up working out really well. And we have plans of going out in the States next summer. That's like kind of what we're doing. We had something booked in February that unfortunately did not end up working out, just because one of the other my booking agent said that there was issues with one of the other bands, and some of the dates weren't working out as well, which was unfortunate. But like next summer, like I think we're going to, like, we're pushing really hard to get down to the East Coast and hopefully get into New York, get into Jersey, get into everything around there, just because, like, I know how well the scenes do there and how, like, there's so many people that you can play, like, a bunch of cities all 30 minutes apart from each other, whereas, like, in Ontario, yeah, you can't do that. So, yeah, like, we went on our first, like, tour or run in August, and we're just, like, kind of just, like, doing weekend runs and stuff until I'm unfortunately in school right now. So as soon as that's done, it's once again back on the road, just...
It's those like break away tours that you're able to, yeah, get, like you have a lull in like your life, like, okay, now we got to go on tour and like,
exactly, like that's like literally what it is, run. And that's what's now, gonna be.
If you guys ever come down to South Jersey again, hit up Jose Martinez. Grandeur Booking knows what they're doing.
Definitely keep that in mind. That's the thing. I feel like we've been posting a lot, the EP a lot. We've been trying to plug it a lot, especially in the Defend Pop Punk group, because it has so many people from the States that we have a hard time connecting to. It's kind of funny. Like, I posted this the other day. Because Canada itself doesn't have, like, near as many people as the States does, like, anywhere close to as much, like, getting, like, 2,000 likes on Facebook is, like, difficult, because you're trying to reach out to, like, people. Like, the biggest cities in Canada have, like, a million or two people each, whereas, like, in the States, that's, like, New Jersey itself has, like, what, like, 5 million people, 6 million people, something like that?
I honestly don't know
the Jersey number off the top of my head, but...
And it's, like, but it's, like, a pretty small state, whereas, like, over the course of Ontario, you know, like, there's just, like, hours and gaps of, like, no one, you know? So,
And New Jersey is actually 8.899 million.
Wow.
That's crazy. Like, really? I'm pretty sure Toronto is Canada's, like, largest population, and there's, like, 2 million people in the city, you know what I mean? But then everywhere around it, as soon as you get out of the city, there's, like, literally, like, there will be, like, you can drive hours of just, like, country and no one. You know, just like just forests and country and no one that lives there, because there's such a low population. It's almost hard for like bands like ourselves. Like, I think we're like almost at 2,000 likes to get that amount of likes. So we've been plugging it a lot in the Defend Pop Punk group, being like, hey, we're trying to like share the message as much as we can. Like, check us out. And like, we've gotten a really cool response, and a lot of people have been like, yo, hit me up when you're coming through here, you know, oh, message this guy. And like, that's sweet, and that's what we're trying to do, is like connect with as many people as we possibly can, because like, that's gonna be like, if we can get in the States, if we can do that like we want to, I think it'll be like a huge thing for the band, that we're like, couldn't be more stoked to do it, you know. Absolutely. And I guess I'm definitely gonna keep every person that's messaged me. I've like written them down like a Word document, being like, okay, so when we start booking, I will message all of these people and just get on it, you know, and just like just push as hard as we can. So, but yeah,
that's fantastic. Now my next question was actually gonna be, not to trample on everyone else's question, but it kind of goes synonymous. How would you say that your scene is in your town? Because like you were saying, like you know, like, oh, we have the States, and like, you know, we have everybody that's able to the East Coast having a strong scene, and you guys are playing like a good amount of shows for a winter, you know, just like I think it's like, what, you have a 6 or 7 day tour?
Oh no, that's only 4 actually.
It's only four.
It's okay. Yeah, no.
I went to go look at the picture. I'm like, I don't know any of these towns. I can't really read them, but I do know that you guys are going on tour. So.
Yeah. Well, it's when we did Ontario in August, we did 8 dates over the course of 10 days, with 1 day off in between. Ottawa, which is 5 hours from like where we are, and I think we just like had a date that ended up falling through, so we only ended up doing 8 days over 10 days. And Ontario itself is like, right now I feel like there are so many like amazing bands coming out of, especially like where I'm from, Hamilton, and the scene in general. I know tomorrow my like good friends in Lake Pacific are announcing something huge that I know about, and I'm like so stoked for them that they're doing what they're doing. And you know, like Seaway is from Ontario, and there's a band called Safe to Say that's also from Ontario, and they're also like really really sick. There's a lot of like really great bands, but places to play are kind of few and far between. And it's really hard for bands, I guess you could say, to kind of, like, get out of their, like, town. Because, like, as pop punk as it sounds, it's because there's not a lot of other places to play and not a lot of people going to shows. We've been able to play a fair amount of shows since we started the band, simply because we, like, took a lot of, like, crappy shows that didn't matter and we just wanted to play. And now it's, like, you know, doing that, we play to a lot of people that... we played a lot of people that wouldn't normally hear us, and that kind of, like, helped build it. Now we can, like, play places, like, pretty frequently all over Ontario and be like, hey, we'll at least be able to bring out people that'll cover our guarantee and like, come hang out and, like, you know, buy drinks at the bar and stuff like that. The city that I'm from, Hamilton, the scene, I'd say, is probably the most thriving that I've seen in, at least in Ontario. And I'm not just saying that because I'm from there, but because, like, we'll do shows with, like, our friends' bands and, like, other bands in Hamilton, and, like, we'll be able to bring out, like, 200, 250 kids to a show, you know what I mean? That are just, like, local bands. And for Ontario, like, we went on, like, tour in August, and, like, we played, like, a lot of shows to, like, five kids, you know? And it's not, I feel like the Ontario scene itself is producing great bands, but not a lot of people that are going to shows, unfortunately. And there are certain cities, like, obviously Toronto is such a big city that people will go, and people will go see bands, and, like there's a lot of, like, underground, like, house shows going on there. But there's a lot of towns that are kind of just, like, kids just aren't into it. There aren't the bands that are playing that are willing to bring out the people, I really want to say that the scene is thriving in Ontario and where I'm from, but at the end of the day, it's thriving where, like, the city where I'm from, but it's not thriving all over Ontario, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's producing all these great bands that I it's like they're going to need to be picked up, or they're going to need that, like, extra push from someone else who's going to get them other places in order to, like, do something, or else they're just going to inevitably fall apart, you know? And kind of what I was saying about, like, the Facebook likes, you know, like, I feel like it's kind of standard for bands that I've seen, at least from the States, to have, like, 2,000, 3,000 Facebook likes as kind of just, like, a minimum kind of thing, you know, or like, at least, like, 1,500 for bands that I'm, like, I listen to it and you know, I'm like, ah, this band's not that great. I don't understand why they have, like, almost as many Facebook likes as my band, not because I'm like, oh, I'm, like, better than them, but, like, we've been pushing it so hard, and these guys have played five shows, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
And that's kind of what I was trying to say, is that, like, it's so easy to connect with a lot of people because it's so, like, not even overpopulated, there's just so many people, you know? And
TPP is just so overpopulated.
Yeah.
And the scene itself, it's kind of like a, I want to say it's thriving. It's not quite thriving. It's getting there. There's some places, Ottawa, Toronto, Hamilton, London, all these places are kind of far apart, and everything in between is kind of, like, not so great, you know? It's fortunate for us that, like, my band, like, three of us are from Hamilton and three of us are from Brampton, and those cities are an hour apart, and Brampton's really close to Toronto. So when we play Toronto, we're kind of like, we can, like, no, like, be a Toronto local because we have friends from Toronto because it's close to Toronto. So when we play Hamilton, we have, like, a whole other city with a whole other, like, market of people that we can bring out to shows and stuff like that, which is really cool. And I guess it's just, like, we're playing, like, Windsor, which is 3 hours from us. We're playing Cambridge, which is an hour from us. We're also doing a house show in Burlington with Meridian, which is from New York, right?
Yeah.
And then Burlington's right beside Hamilton, and then we're also doing Toronto. And it's, like, it's cool that we're able to play these shows. Most of them will do well. Hopefully they'll do well. I don't want to, like, be that band that, like, says, oh, yeah, we'll bring people out, and then no one shows up, and then the promoter loses money, and we're, like, assholes. But, honestly... It is what it is. It's I think that there are a lot of great bands coming up and not a lot of people going to shows, which is kind of unfortunate. And it's cool for us that we're, like, in a position where we can play shows, like, out of town, that I know a lot of bands aren't in that position because they just don't have the people or the connections that are willing to come in order for them to get, like, actually paid, you know?
Right.
But it just kind of is what it is, you know? So.
Gotcha. Actually, go.
All right. So you were saying that you don't feel that a lot of people really come out to shows in certain areas of Canada. What do you think would be a way to sort of remedy that, like, situation? Like, if you had to sort of, like, give advice to, like, you know, like, trying to get people to come out to shows and, you know.
Well, okay, I think
in other, like, scenes that aren't as thriving as where you're from.
I think a big part of it is just, like, just take shows where, like, don't, like, just, like, be that band that will, like, kind of pester a promoter about putting you on the show and just be like, yeah, like, we don't need gas money, we just want to play, kind of just, like, pay your dues. It's like, that's what we did. We paid our dues for a long time. And honestly, at the end of the day, it's like, you obviously have to market yourself. Obviously, there's all that, like, social media is a big part of it, be able to connect with people. But I feel like for most bands, if I could recommend anything to them, is, like, do the best you can, obviously, try to get people out. But if you aren't from a place that's thriving, then I would look for outside places to go and outside places to post and outside places to promote and go to the States. Just head south and go to the States.
Right. It's all about the connections you make.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it is what it is. It's as simple as that. It's kind of hard to say, especially with my band. Like, we're just doing the best we can, and we just want to tour and play as many shows as we can and pay your dues and connect with people. But ultimately, like, that's all you can do, and hope for the best. Just honestly hope for the best. So.
Makes sense. Dan, you yawned, and then, like, I try my hardest to keep that other yawn in, and then... Anyway, but Dan, you can ask your question.
All right, so... Are there any other, like, local bands in your area that you guys like to play shows with?
Yeah, like, we're, I'm really good friends with this band called Parkside. They're honestly so good, and no one knows about them, and I want everyone to know about them. We play shows with them all the time. They're, like, really, really close friends of ours. We recently did a weekend run with them and a band called Keepsake. They're from, the same city as us, and, they're also, like, super cool dudes. That band is, like, if they don't do big things, I'll be, like, really upset about it. I actually used to be in a band called Face Value that's from Ontario that I played bass for while I was doing Fighting Season. And they're, like, they're still doing that band, and they're about to, like, do some cool stuff. We're friends with a band called Harbor. My friend Dan is in a band called Full Swing. And they're, like, they're super good. He lives with me. They're a super good band. Just trying to think of other bands so I don't miss any one. There's a band called July that's from Brampton. They were on that, like, Hit the Lights, Major League Brigades tour, like, the Skip School Starts Fights tour last year. Their drummer is, like, records my band. And they're super cool dudes. They don't have a singer right now, so if anyone's looking for a band and wants to be in a band that's actually, like, pretty cool... Go join that band. Cold Front's another band. They're from Burlington, which is right beside Hamilton. They're super cool dudes. They're on tour with Meridian at the end of December, and they're coming to the States. And then I know that they're also planning some, like, stuff in the States later on, or, like, for 2015. So I guess all those bands, like, those bands we love to play shows with. It's cool because, like, I feel like a lot of my close friends are in bands that are awesome, like, bands that are way too good to be the size that they're at. And I feel like that's, like, the common thing with, like, at least Canada now is, like, there's going to be a lot of Canadian pop punk bands that I really, really hope will make it out. And if they do, like, it'll be a thing. You know, the Seaway kind of, like, started it. And now it's going to be so many bands, you know, like Pacific, Safe to Say that I mentioned before. And yeah, hopefully, I mean, like, Parkside, hopefully Keepsake.
And you had a Living with Lions before that, you know. That were doing stuff with, you know, like the Wonder Years and stuff. They were friends with all of them.
Exactly.
Know? And then Seaway completely blew it open. So, you know, now it's cool that now that community is getting a lot of exposure, because it sounds like there's really a lot of, like, cool stuff going on up that way, you know.
For sure. It definitely, like, it's cool being in, like, being friends with bands that are some of your, like, honestly, like, some of my favorite bands, like, bands that, like, I will actually, like, learn their songs and play them, you know what I mean? Right. And Living with Lions, they're from the West Coast, They're from out in BC, and I know that like they, you know, managed to make it out there, and that's like sick for them, and I hope that Seaway is just merely like a stepping stone into the future of like Canadian pop punk and Canadian bands kind of like jumping into like a bigger thing and getting the scenes going and getting into the States and people seeing like Seaway. Like I remember when they posted the video for Sabrina back in like 2000, and I think it was 2011. And like now that they're doing like they're on like a tour with Senses Fail, like that's crazy. I love Senses Fail. You know what I mean? And like, they were like a small band, and now they're like doing these absolutely huge things. So, a lot of great stuff's going on, and I honestly just hope for the best for all my friends and all these bands that are coming out.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's all really cool stuff that it sounds like they're all up to.
For sure.
Yeah, it seems really, really awesome.
It really does. And for our final question before we jump into your showcase, would there be any advice that you would give to any other band or or anyone that's trying to become a part of our music scene?
Honestly, like, just if you're not in a band and you want to go to shows, just go. I feel like a lot of people I know are like afraid of going to shows. They're afraid of seeing live music because they're worried they're gonna like get hurt and stuff like that. And I think like the only advice I can give them is just go and meet people. I book shows in the city that I'm from, and I always try to like preach like a really accepting community, like no matter who you are, where you came from, you belong here kind of thing. And I guess that like the only advice I'd give to other people that are in the scene or people that are doing their thing or want to be involved or want to start a band is just honestly, like, if you're like a decent human being and you want people to go and you want people to do well, then don't be like, get rid of the ego, like leave all your shit at the door, be accepting, be open with people, be honest and make connections and talk with people and develop those relationships, because that's only going to help the scene grow. It's only going to help bands grow. It's only going to do good things for everyone. You know, I hate to say it. I know there's a lot of people kind of that I know that are in bands that are kind of like, they kind of have like their egos about things. They don't care. And they're kind of just like dicks. And honestly, in the past, I can say that like, I've kind of let things get to my head and shit like that. And I think a big part of it, the only advice I give to people is if you're going to come, show up, have a good time and do the best you can to support everyone. I think that there needs to be a real community in order for anyone to do anything. There can't be this like people going behind each other's backs. It has to be real support for everyone. And I think that's the only advice I give to people is no matter where you are, just build your community and do what you can and show up and no one should say anything about you. That's not what it's about. It shouldn't be about that kind of stuff, you know? So I guess that's the only advice I could give to anyone who is in a band or wants to be in a band or wants to go to shows or wants to be like in the scene, you know? Just come with an open mind and be a respectful person, and that's what it is, you know? So.
That sounds fantastic. I mean, like, regardless, that's how you approach anything, but especially in a music community where we thrive on helping each other.
Exactly.
One band cannot carry itself. You still need your network to help you out.
Well, I mean, like, when we talked earlier in the show about, you know, Warped Tour bands and these huge bands repping these other bands that are, like, slowly gaining popularity, that's what it is. You know, like, I saw the dudes from 5 Seconds of Summer tweet about State Champs, and then I went on State Champs, like, the video for Elevated that he posted, and it was, like, so many people that were like, oh, Luke from 5 Seconds of Summer posted me here. And it's, like, that's such a large community, but it's, like, that's what you need to do. These bands need to rep other bands. They need to promote their friends and try to be as helpful as possible. It's all community, no matter how big or how small you are. And that's just only what's going to help people grow and help more people get into music and help everyone like do what they can, you know? So
there we
absolutely
go. All right. Yeah. So that's Matt of Finding Season giving his words of advice to everybody. So we're actually going to jump into our showcase of your song, and we're Fighting Season song. And I believe you told us that you wanted to play Temple. Now, do you want to give a quick blurb about it before we play?
Yeah, this is the song I was talking about earlier, mentioning about a friend of mine and the situation he was going through. And I kind of, like, there's this latency on what I'm saying. and it's messing
with a weird echo.
Sorry. That's my fault.
Have you guys seen those videos of the people? They put like the delay on their voice, and they put their headphones in. They're trying to talk, and it comes out as like mumbled words, like just like. Yeah. Have you seen? That's what it was about to do for me.
I got a little too early.
it's cool. It's about a friend of mine who's going through some stuff, and we had a conversation about some of the things he was going through, and how, and essentially the song's just about being like kind of like frustrated with everything you're doing, just trying to like do the best you can, and realizing that everything you're doing is not doing doesn't matter at the end of the day, and that you want to make a change for yourself, and I guess make things better. And this song was my way of making things better and coming to terms with that. And in my opinion, this is actually the first song we wrote on the EP, and in my opinion, it's my favorite song off the EP, and I hope people like it.
Yeah, all right, let's go.
Can I let you fall? My feet this year, like it meant nothing at all to anyone or anything. Well, you used to mean the world to me. I never thought I'd grow this cold. I've been bitter all this winter. I'm better off alone.
Just by like listening to that song another time, just how good it is. Like,
yeah.
Like, I mean, I listened to it earlier today.
Yeah.
And like, maybe I wasn't giving it like all the focus that I should have, because I was just like listening to it now. I'm like, damn, this is really, really good. Like.
And that's a trend I'm starting to find in a lot of these bands that we're bringing on. It's just like the actual content that they're driving into the songs that. See, at least that I believe, we're used to hearing, like you know, narratives and, like, you know, analogies. And, like, not a lot of bands are actually throwing in, like, here's straight, pure honesty, and we're just going to fucking give it to you right on its own platter without, yeah. like, any seasoning. And it's fantastic. It's raw. It's beautiful.
honestly, like, thanks so much, guys. I really, really appreciate it. You know, we put so much effort into the EP that we just put out, and I'm really glad that you guys like the songs. It means a lot to me.
Absolutely. I mean, we love showcasing some kick-ass bands here. But our time has run out for tonight. Matt from Fighting Season, let's give the man a hand.
Woo! Woo! Thank you so much for having me on, guys. I actually had a great time. Everyone that I knew that did it was like, it's so much fun doing it. So I was like, all right, I got to do this.
I'm glad everyone's saying we're having fun. Yeah. That's fun. We like to have good fun to have on Baby.
Yeah.
Plus, like I said, with the right before we actually went on the air about the whole, I watched the entire About That Life interview, all 3 hours of it, and I laughed. And I don't think I've laughed harder at many things before, so I was like, all right, I got to do this. So thank you so much for having me on.
Absolutely, and keep us up to date with anything that we're doing. We're always welcome to share more stuff that cool bands are doing, all right?
Sounds good. Thank you so much.
All right, so from everyone here at Babetalk, enjoy the rest of your night, everyone.
See you next week, everybody.